Thank you. Thanks for introducing me, Adam. And I will be talking about our experience in exposing the CDataNet metadata catalogs via Sparkling Points. It's a teamwork funded by CData Cloud, and Adam and Rob Thomas, that are both here, have contributed massively. Chris Wood, I'm talking on behalf of Chris Wood as well, but other people have contributed to this work as well. So why did we decide to expose the CDataNet catalogs as Sparkling Points? It's because, as defined by the Horizon 2020 Program Guidelines on Fair Data Management, in general terms, your research data should be fair, that is, findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. And by exposing the CDataNet catalogs as Sparkling Points, we get two ticks, making our metadata findable and interoperable. Now, why we decided to expose them as Sparkling Points is because Spark is to link data what SQL is to relational databases. So it's a W3C standard query language for the resource description framework RDF data. You manage to have Sparkling Points publicly available, and you're able to query them all together with one standard language, which is Sparkle. Now, we said a lot of terms that you probably or maybe didn't know, but as most of you know, the World Wide Web is evolving from hypertext to hyperdata. So instead of linking documents, we now try to link data. So as Sir Tim Berners-Lee said in 2006, the semantic web is not just about putting data on the web, it is about making the links so that a person or a machine can explore the web of data. And with linked data, when you have some of it, then you can find other related data, even if you don't know what you will be doing with them yet. So what is linked data? It can be referred as a technology or just a set of rules. So the first one is to use URIs as name for things. I decided to put Hania, which is my hometown, there from DBpedia. And then if you use a URI, it's better to use an HTTP URI so that other people can look up those names. When they look up those names, it's important to provide useful information, and it's more important to provide this information using standards like the Resource Description Framework and Sparkle. And finally, it's even better to include links to other URLs so that they can discover more things. So, one more slide on background. And as Michelle has introduced about CDataNet catalogs, CDataNet holds catalogs about organization metadata, project metadata through the EDMERP catalog, crew summary reports through the CSR catalog, observing programs metadata through the EDIOS catalog, and data sets through the EDMED catalog. All these catalogs have been exposed on the web through their proprietary web search interfaces, and they are hosted in four different data centers in relational databases. So what we did, so now let's see what we finally did. So in order to make them interoperable, we had to map them to existing ontologies and existing patterns. And why we used existing patterns is because we would make our catalogs better understood outside of CDataNet. So they are not understood only inside our closed environment, but They are understood by others as well. They are better interoperable with other organizations, and they get a better Inspire compliance. Now, this is how the catalogs were mapped to the existing ontologies. So Adam has made this modeling, which is a brilliant work because it's massive. So he chose W3C organization ontology to map EDMO, the organization catalog, the W3C DCAT ontology for EDMED, the PROV ontology and the DBpedia research project ontology for the EDMERP catalog, the W3CD catalog for CDIs, the mapped Inspire ONM to the ODV metadata, the Inspire, he used the Inspire environmental monitoring facilities to map to EDIOS, and for the crew summary reports, there was no available ontology. So in liaison with the US NSF rolling deck to repository and Australian colleagues through the ODIP project, they created the crew summary report ontology, which is this one. Cindy, you must have been in this one.
Yes.
Cindy was included in this one. So, so that was about the modeling and the mapping of all these catalogs. Next step was to implement these catalogs as Spark endpoints. So as we said before, these catalogs were stored at four different, and they are still stored at four different institutions across Europe. So we found it very important to harmonize the URIs, to have a harmonized shared domain. We didn't put any requirement on technical implementations for the catalog holders. And BODC chose a certain way of implementing it by using the Apache Jenna stack and writing some custom ingestion code to ensure that the catalogs are kept, the sparkling points are kept up to date. This is the URLs that we came up with, Peter from Maris and the rest of the partners in this work package. So we have all the same hostname cdatanet.org, but we change the prefix depending on the catalog. Going one step further, on a slash search, you are redirected, or you don't know that you are redirected to the search interface of its catalog. With the slash sparkle, you go to the sparkle endpoint, and then you can have a unique identifier per record per catalog. So that's fully implemented for EDMED. There is a partial implementation for EDMO as well. I think EDIOS hasn't been mapped yet to the harmonized host. There is a little bit of work that needs to be done, but we're pretty much there. I was also doing a federated query that worked well, but I had to do a little bit of workarounds to make it work. And finally, Adam has mapped EDMEDs to schema.org to make them more discoverable through the Google data search engine that has been launched a short while ago and allows datasets that are marked up with a schema.org ontology to appear directly on the Google data search engine. And this is an example of, if you search for the Marine Institute in Ireland, give me all the datasets of the Marine Institute in Ireland that have been tagged up with the schema.org ontology, this is what you will be getting. Finally, what we learned and our conclusions is that the RDF model is an important and powerful technology to discover and deliver data and metadata. I hear that many people are a little bit afraid of this technology and stay away, but like with any new technology, implementation can have a steep learning curve, but if you get there, it feels Okay. So for third-party developers, other types of APIs can be more familiar to them, but they can be less powerful. Chris thought that it is important to consider three different types of user groups: the internal users, the third-party developers, and the external users, because a Spark claim point may not be directly directed for a scientist. It could be just for a machine, and then the scientist can leverage the possibilities of a Spark claim point through a nice user-friendly interface rather than going there and write Sparkle queries. And the investment required to make and populate a triple store of your data will be both worth it, and your users will appreciate it. Future directions is, as we said before, creating applications on top of the Spark claim points to make them more user-friendly. Write some example queries so that people can play with them and feel more confident using them. And while being able to gather more data, we can come towards information, and then from information, we can create knowledge that we may not even know that is there yet. Last future direction: to make our metadata catalogs fully fair. Some slides from previous work if you want to know more. Acknowledgements to all of these people and projects. And thank you for your attention.